It's a joy to be with you, and it's good to see Brother Clem, Brother Aurelio. We have been going through the seals, the most critical subject of this our time, because we have to be sealed. There's no middle ground. It's either the seal of the living God or somebody else is going to stamp us for themselves, for their camp. It's only two camps. All right, so I'm going to try and share a few things if they're still here. I know I did restart the computer, so I have to look for it again. Here's one. See if that will open. Offices. All right, I'm still getting issues. I'm sorry, this program just won't start at all today.
Making a move to put him into a nursing home.
Oh boy.
Yeah, that, no, we don't want that because, you know, that's a death sentence, right?
Yeah, exactly.
He's not one who sits quietly, and the first thing we're going to do is to sedate him. Give him shots and stuff. And then he had military experience, so anytime you rush him, anytime you put him in a situation, he tends to be violent. He fights.
Yeah. Gotcha.
In his own home, he's fine. The thing is that he's leaving, he walks out all the time. They have an issue with that.
Gotcha.
Because the people, the caretakers were there and not doing a very good job of caretaking. So the last time he walked out about 3 weeks ago, both the lady who was there and the person she paid to take of him were in the house.
Oh boy.
And neither of them knew that he was gone.
Yeah,
they tried to bring him back home.
Yeah.
And he was down by the highway. He had left that long to walk because the highway's not 5 miles from the house. The highway's a good half an hour or 5 miles from the house. So he was gone for a while.
Wow.
And they, to the point, they know exactly who he is now.
Interrupt us when you're ready, brother.
All right. Yes, you can open up now.
Are you having some issues opening it up, Mark Williams? Getting it on the screen?
Yeah, for a while. I don't know what's happened. I know everything is brand spanking new here, so. It has been working well, but.
Yeah, that's true.
But something went wrong. But anyway, I'm ready to put up one and see if I can get another one. So let me share. I'm going to share this one and then I'll come back to where we have to review. Well, let me start with the review tonight. Let me start with the review tonight. We will start with the third seal, because the third seal has a lot of symbolism. Since you left, we went back, because as we get to this point of the seal, where God is restoring by the last three seals, we'll have to go back to some of the scriptures in order to sort of get a grip on the things, the base of the prophecy. Because if you recall, all the books of the Bible meet and end in Revelation, and Revelation is a complement of Daniel. So, for example, and then other books too. And for example, when we look at the third seal, we saw, first of all, that the horse was black. Anybody want to read that? Let's catch up with that. The third seal, Revelation 6. That would be Revelation 6. Let me open up that and see where that is. Turn to Revelation 6 for me and see if you get that.
The third, Revelation 6.
And the third seal.
Third seal, just want to read that?
Yeah, just the third seal. Read all of it.
It said when he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come and see." So I looked and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hands. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine."
Right. So those three categories that are outlined from the third seal, we have been digging into it since you left. And of course we went back and we had to go to Matthew chapter 20 and did the 1 hour, the one day that is referred to as our day of salvation. A night part of it takes care of the period of time when the Word of God was orally transmitted. In other words, man, God spoke to man and man spoke to their sons, and so that's how the Word was carried on for a period of time, the first maybe 2500 years, up to Moses really. Moses started the Bible, so when the Bible started to be written, God start the day of our salvation, and therefore we saw in that period, which we will have to go back and look on that, because it is quite a comprehensive study that we need to have that base as we go forward. But anyway, we saw in that the householder, it was a parable regarding the householder. He went out 5 different times during the day, and that proves to us the legitimate calls or the legitimate movements that God has called. Because what he does, he called the people. For example, he called the Israelite with a special message, with the message of the ceremonial system. And so they serve a period which is symbolized with 3 hours, which takes them to the third hour of the day. The third hour of the day brings to a close the ceremonial system, and that shows us that Christ and the New Testament church came on the stage. And so it is showing us that the Israelites, the ancient Israel, was one movement that God has called out. No matter what people say, that's the one God used to get to others. That's the idea here. The principle is that in every generation, in every dispensation, God has called out a people to whom he speaks to the world. And that is the pattern that we have seen there. And so the penny was highlighted there, that the penny that this seal is talking about, a penny a day, showed us that there were 2 Israelites there that God called. He called ancient Israel and he called modern Israel at the 11th hour. Well, he called modern Israel, and within the period of modern Israel, he called a layman movement. And we have looked on that, and we have discussed it. So we'll have to do that since you are now, you know, so that you can catch up with that. Now we have to catch up with something else, because at the same time, in this period of this horse, this seal, it showed that the Bible was written. That's the beginning of the Bible, because it falls under the time when the Bible was written. That's why God gave the command to hurt not the oil and the wine. And so we discovered that the oil is the Word of God, from under the influence of the Holy Spirit, is represented by oil. And we went other places. For example, Zechariah chapter 4, we saw there 2 olive trees, and we observed that it was the two pipes were taking oil, extracting oil from the olive trees. The 2 olive trees represent the Old and New Testament, and you can find that in Great Controversy 670-something. We can go back there. All right, what are we going to do in this time? We're going to take you to to something else that we reviewed in this chart. Now, in this chart, we moved on to the fourth seal. So please read the fourth seal from. We moved on to that. So we're going to go back to some of the things that we saw.
Okay. Fourth seal. When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the 4 living creatures saying, "Come and see."
Come and
see. So I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and the name of him who sat on it was Death, and Hades followed with him. And power was given to them over the fourth of the earth, to kill with the sword, with hunger, and with death, and the beast of the earth.
Okay, so let me go to the fourth seal since we are... Well, this is what I was just telling you about. This is an ancient timepiece, but it's the face of a clock, and it is actually giving us the different calls that God made in the day and in the night. Now, a line is drawn across the clock, an imaginary line, and so the bottom half is the night period. And the night period actually started from the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden down here. And you notice there are a few patterns that have been developed that from the time of Adam, counting on the clock of our salvation, and again, it symbolizes our salvation from the beginning of the world to the second coming of Christ. Right? That's what this clock is about. So it's like when you're doing technical drawing, you scale, you bring things to scale. So that's how the Bible do things. So what it does, it gives us half of the clock. And if you notice the numbering of the clock, is not like our. This is what some people use now who are living near the equator, where the night and day is equal. So they would use this type of timepiece. So here we have Moses, and he's given this message. The message of the ceremonial system, the sanctuary, you know. And this was pointing to Christ. So when Christ came, it was a new message. And then after Christ, we have to look for another new revelation. That's one of the marks that identify what the next call. The next new revelation after the New Testament church is the judgment of the 2300 days. And that was first given to William Miller, a farmer, who was called by God, and he brought forth a sanctuary. Even though he made a mistake, God's hands was over it, but he called, he thought Christ was going to be on earth. But it was really in the heavenly sanctuary. So that was the next new one. And then the next one after that is the revelation of the sanctuary and the Sabbath, which is the Seventh-day Adventist. This is modern Israel. So we have ancient Israel, and then modern, as ancient Israel that start, and modern Israel to finish. But unfortunately, what we discover is God called an 11th hour worker, giving them 1 hour to finish the gospel work. When we study this, these are representing the laymen who will finish the gospel work. And God has reached seven, with the Seventh-day Adventist, he has reached number seven. And so he couldn't call another organization, so he had to go within. He had to spruce up this one and use those who are willing to, because the leaders, they fall off the truck, really. They reject some of the messages. All right, so that's where we go. On the bottom here in the night, this is a oral tradition. And so if you're looking here, you see Adam and Eve in clothing out of the garden. And the first message here was Enoch. Enoch was called during the night period. He was the first one, really. And he had the message of calling the people to judgment. And then Noah's message. And so we have five calls in the top, or five movements. And then we have down here, you must find seven. That is why we can only have five in the day. All right, so We will read the Bible and go over it again. We're running to the third seal, the oil and the wine, that we talk about that. So here we have the fourth seal. Now, why are we going back in history about this seal? You just read that he was given power over the earth for what period of time? What's the characteristics of this being? Of course, death was riding the horse. The horse was pale. Is there a pale color? Is there such a color as pale? No, there's not such a color as pale. What pale is saying is that it's indescribable. It is man-made. That means it is referring to the empire of Rome. And so it is talking about, just as Daniel, a nondescript beast. And why Rome is referred to as nondescript is because it is a despicable conglomeration of Jewish Christians and Rome. So it has these functions that you can't really know what it is about. That's Rome, and that's why the Bible refers to Rome as nondescript. So since we are in the seal, and the seal is showing the same period, the seal is showing you that it's bringing out the part of the killing, the massacre, and the martyrdom that Rome carried out. So, of course, we know Rome is in two phases, pagan and papal. Pagan Rome, you know, is that political power, but papal Rome is that combination of church and state. And so the church was able to legislate the civil law when they joined. The church became the ruler. Alright, so we say not a specific color, and it serves the same period as the beast of Daniel 7 and 8. Daniel 7, 7 and 8, and we will go back there and check it out. The period of ancient Rome government, the color denotes a mixture of paganism and Christianity. Well, here's what we're talking about. In Daniel, you'll find this. These are production of what the Bible says, so a picture is worth a thousand words. These, pagan Rome, begun in AD 476. No, 476, and but it is in two phases, pagan. Why do we know the difference with the beast? That this is pagan and this is papal. Any significant mark on that tells you that it is a religious political power?
You see that face of a man.
Yes.
Is three of the horns.
Yes.
You know that
paper. That's a papacy.
Yeah, papacy shifting up from the political to now state and church.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
So which one is that? Well, I'm trying to remember the little horn. The little horn would be papacy.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. This is when Rome, pagan, was martyring the saints, was killing. But it was working, because the more they killed the Christians, the more they spread. The Bible described them as locusts. You know, the nature of locust is to swarm. And you execute, but they swarm more. So they were doing that, but they realized that the strategy was not working. So history tells you that pagan Rome fell, because, you know, powers fall and powers rise. But it's a strategy that they work out, and they start paying the pagans to join the church. And they force them and they pay them. Those who refused, they kill them too, like, or they used to kill the Christians. So that's when, and combined with Constantine, the Roman general, who, when he was converted to Christianity and all that, so the church and the state came together. Okay. And that's what the Bible referred to as the horn head. And when they came together, there were three, the Ostrogoths, the Orientals, and the Vandals. Those are three little nations that didn't want to come together with them under there, and they disseminate those nations. Those were referred to as the three horns that was uprooted. So they wiped out three nations. Alright, so what we put them side by side to show you that they are representing the same period. But there's something why we have to go back in history, and it's therefore it was beyond description, as previously explained. Rome killed thousands of people, especially Christians. All right, and because they killed pagans also. read this for me, somebody.
So this is a perfect description of the unjust persecuting Roman power corresponding to the beast Daniel saw it. It devoured and it broke break in pieces and scattered the residue at the foot of it. Mm-hmm. In the opening of the fourth seal, Daniel chapter 7, verse 7, Rome, under the symbol of the non-destruct beast, wrote his stages, mm-hmm. imperial and papal.
Yeah.
Death and hell follow him wherever he goeth, as the Bible said. You know. So this is from Great Controversy 272, paragraph 3.
Okay. Yes. Yes. So that's Rome. But it is saying something that I want to go. Look at what else did Rome do? Power was given unto them over the fourth part. So this is something that we have to dig into. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth. What does that mean, really? Well, Rome actually didn't control only a fourth of the then world, and that is what we want to look at now, what Rome really controlled. In terms of the then known world.
Was that a question you asked, Brother Williams, or your statement you're making?
Yeah, making us, well, I'm reading a statement there. It said that they were given, that they were given power over a fourth of the earth, right? Is that what it reads?
Right.
Okay. Alright. So, this is just review because we did this last time, but here is what happened. Now, when Alexander been, and we will have to go through this now, through that scripture. But I'm just giving an overview and touch on what we did last time. Now, in Daniel 8, there's a description of these powers, these empires. But Daniel 7 gives you a description that the wind would blow upon the sea, and then these beasts, hefty beasts, would rise up out of the sea. Anybody knows what that really is saying to us? When the wind, what is the wind and what caused this, the animal to come up? Familiar.
Talking about in terms,
yeah.
In terms of the movement, are you talking in terms of the movement of the nations across the, on the, I'm not quite following the question, sorry.
Well, the question is, Daniel 7 tells us, I don't know if you want to read it rightly. Anybody?
Daniel 7?
Yeah, since we have to deal with these, you have to turn your Bible right, or pull it up and just keep it on the iPad so that you can touch these scriptures. Daniel 7 say that Daniel saw the wind blow upon the sea. And then after that, as a result of blowing on the sea, some beasts rise up out of the sea. You know what that that phrase is? Or read it for me, somebody. Daniel 7.
I see here it says, Daniel spoke, saying, I saw in my vision by night, behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts came up from the sea, each different from the other.
All right.
First was like,
Stop there. Do you understand what you read?
For the most part, that the winds were stirring up and the beast came out of this, the sea.
Yeah, do you understand that? No? Brother Clem, you want to tell them?
So,
wind. But first of all, just identify the symbol. Yeah. Yes, the symbols.
Sea would be people or right?
Yes. Yeah.
But we know in Revelation that wind is symbol of strife, right?
Yes.
So, in Daniel, that the wind that, or the movement of the, as you read, then the sea, strife. Sea being Europe, mm-hmm. as opposed to the land being America, as we will read later in 13. And among the nations, as Daniel chapter 2 said, that they will never cleave one to the other. You know, the clay and the iron.
Mm-hmm.
So there was strife among them. And then what, as we notice that the nations were always at war, wrestling for power amongst each other, and the strife rose up. I don't know if there is something in particular you're getting at, Brother Williams.
Well, I just want us to understand the basic. So, in doing this subject, do you remember where we said nations and strife were born originally?
Yes. Yeah, that was after Adam sometime, I forget.
Yeah, the Tower of Babel. Well, if you keep your Bible handy, you can just see. It's after it's after the flood. After the flood, when languages were changed, yes, at the Tower of Babel, nations were born actually, because people start going to their different places, they have different languages. So actually under the red horse, it would take to peace from the earth. So it is, the Bible is describing it in Daniel here as wind, which is strife, war. Nations warring against nations, because there is conquest that caused one to go down and one to come up. So Daniel is actually showing us the history of our world and the empires, the political aspect, of course, regarding, because it has, it is key to understand the church, because we are concerned about the church, but since prophecy and history go hand in hand, we have to know the history, because that's how God writes it. The Bible is written in this way so that we can see prophecy and history together. So when he said that, we started really, we can visualize that Assyria was born at the Tower of Babel and became one of the first powerful nations. And they took the Israelites, the 10 tribes, into captivity, the Assyrians. Now Babylon rose up after that. How did Babylon get to come up to be the world power? By striking Assyria, right?
Yeah, and Egypt.
Yes. Whatever power was there, a power, you have to come up and strategize and take them down. And so that's how we get Babylon, God put it, the first world empire, represented in Daniel 7 by a lion with two wings. The two wings, we discussed that wings are really period of time, showing that when Babylon came, it wasn't really the first world empire. There was an empire before. That's what wings always means, period of time. Anyway, we're just looking at all the nations go. Now, when this one came on the stage, this one is out. That's what happened. They are not on the stage at the same time.
Media pressure came, Babylon falls out.
Yes.
To take over, Greece.
Greece.
Media pressure falls out.
Yes.
Rome takes over.
Yes.
Greece falls out.
Ah. To become to the world now, where we don't have a world empire, we have a splinter of nations, because they can't come together to form a world empire. All right, so that being said, if you go to Daniel chapter 8, it gives it the same history with some different beasts. Why is that? Because he's bringing up a different line of truth that we must understand. No one prophet or no one, God doesn't give you the truth all at one time to carry you from the beginning to the end. He gives us meat in due season. And that's why we say every dispensation had a new revelation that we now will refer to as our foundation, as old revelation, our old truth. We have new truth. That's where that term comes. Nothing is new under the sun, but you have to understand that it is new to you, it's new to me, when it is just revealed, that's what it's saying. So I'm showing you now, why we're talking about this, is that Alexander the Great is important to this subject, to Rome occupying a fourth of the world. So we're going to the root to understand where did Rome spring from. Now, Alexander was shown as the notable horn on a he-goat. Alright? You want to read that right quick? Daniel 8, so that you're familiar with what we talk. Let's read through Daniel 8 right quick, somebody. Let me see which verses you need to read. Well, we have Daniel 8, 21, 22.
Read from 7.
But we have 21, 22 on my chart here. Daniel 8, 20 show you.
21 and 22.
Yeah. You can read from, read the line of beast, because it's a different line of beast.
So that's 8:20. So it's the ram which you saw having two horns, they are kings of Media Persia. Right. The male goat is the kingdom of Greece. The large horn is between the eyes is the first king. As for the broken horns and the four that stood up in its place, four kingdoms shall arise out of the nation, but not with its power.
Oh, all right.
It's earlier, five. And I saw a ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. And as I was considering, behold, and a he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler, C-H-O-L-E-R, rage against him, and smote the ram, and broke his two horns, and there was no power in the ram to stand or to withstand him before him. But he cast him down into the ground and trampled and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore the he-goat waxed very great. And when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up four notable horns, notable ones, towards the four winds of heaven, and out of one of them came four little horns, which walks exceedingly great, towards the south and towards the east and towards the pleasant land, and it walks great even to the host of heaven. And it was cast down some of the host of the stars of the ground and stamped upon them. We're getting now into Rome, as you know, and so really, but
yes. What you have read there, there's a production of it on this chart. We can just take a look at this, because I know I have it on some chart, but I can't find it on the computer. But did we pass it? Let me see if we passed it. Or maybe I have it on the other one. All right. Maybe I have it on the other one. I had it on the other one that I was sharing. But what this is telling us is that it's just bringing out the truth regarding the leaders, the empire and the emperors, the leaders. Now, history showed us that this goat is Alexander. Well, this ram, you know the difference with a ram and an he-goat. A ram is always a sheep, and a he-goat is a he-goat, right? Right, so, yeah, so, you notice that.
The two horns on the ram, right?
The yes, here, Medo-Persia. First it had Medo-Persia in the form of a bear. You remember we saw that?
Yeah, was it 7 or...
Yeah, in Daniel 7 it has a bear, but anyway. Let's concentrate on the same power. The reason why it's showing us, as I said, is showing us that the Medes and the Persian is represented by the two horns. Right? One was high, one was low. And it is just telling us that it's two nations that actually merged together, one overthrew the other. The history shows us that they were really family. But anyway, this is where we want to focus. Here you see the he-goat, which is representing the leopard in this case with four head and four wings, is representing the kingdom of Greece, led by Alexander the Great. Started out at the age of about 18, and I think when he got into his 20s, early. But he was very young when he started to marshal and took over the Medes and the Persian, and then started there. Now, Alexander was so young, and he didn't have heir to his throne. He didn't have a son, daughter to take over from him. So these are representing the four generals, or in this case, the four horns. Right? Now that we get that foundation, we're going to now see how Rome came in. Now, again, when the he-goat overtook Medo-Persia, the horn broke off, and this breaking...
I was in verse 8 of chapter 8.
Yeah, what is said in 21 and 22? I don't know why I have 21. What 21 and 22 said?
The Lord read that, right? It said, and the rough goat is the king of Greece. I think this was the interpretation of the verse 8 earlier.
Okay, well, that's right. So, that is telling you exactly what this is talking about. And so, why is it, what does the horn on the ground mean? What does the broken horn mean?
Well, the kingdom was, he lost the kingdom, so to speak.
Yes, and he actually died. He didn't actually lose the kingdom, he ruled.
Right, he died.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. He's no longer in existence.
He actually died. All right. So, in terms of what we're dealing with now, last time we go over this little chart. And I have a color codes where I use to show the empires in terms of territory. And let me say up front that Rome, in terms of anciently and today, or in the 1500, Rome never occupied a quarter. It's either occupied more in the ancient world. It has more than a quarter when we look at it, and less than a quarter in the time of the papacy. And so this is where it shows that Babylon was here, ruled all this area, and for an understanding of what we're talking about, you can see the modern map, and it never lost the area, but you can see the different things that were there. This is the Red Sea, this is the Persian Gulf, and this is the Gaza Strip with Israel and so on, and Jordan and the Black Sea somewhere here beside Jordan. So Iraq was the headquarters, so this is Babylon, all this area. It's like all over the Middle East there, they occupied. That's Babylon. I'm right here. That's Babylon. When Medo-Persia came, they're in blue, they occupied, they took over Babylon, so they would be in charge of the territory, right? So they, once a nation overthrew another nation, they want to broaden their space, they want to broaden their territory. And so what we are seeing is that Medo-Persia made a little glitch back to the side of Asia, but not much. Brown would be the he-goat, Alexander. So Alexander would have occupied the same power, same territory, but he would have expanded. And this is showing you all the areas that Alexander occupied. Went all the way to India, Pakistan, India, all the way in South Asia there, and he extended all the way up almost in Europe, but he, right by the Black Sea, so he touched a little place here, what we have. He moved up, so this was the territory. I remember we're talking about the ancient world, this ancient civilization, right? So Europe was up here, so we have to look down in the Middle East, Egypt, as more the ancient civilization, which is called the sea, because this is where the wind was blowing and these nations were coming up, right? Of course, Rome now in black. Rome occupied the origin of what there was, and then he went all the way up into Europe, London and all that. So Rome occupied almost two-thirds or so of the then known world. Okay. This is more like us, we have to nine. This is more like so let's look at, so this is the more modern map of the territory of modern of the world. Now, right here, out of those four horns, the Bible tells us that when Alexander died, there were four generals. The four generals are Seleucus, Ptolemy, Lysimachus, and Cassandra. And if you notice, they divided up the empire of Alexander of Greece, right? So division starts. So these are occupying their own little territory now. Now, as the whole world continued, Lysimachus overthrew Cassandra. And so Lysimachus was controlling all of this. Seleucus overthrew Lysimachus. So therefore, Seleucus was controlling all the way here. All the way here. So how many nations now we have?
From his kingdom is two.
Two.
Ptolemy and Lysimachus.
Yes. Where is this? Where is Ptolemy?
This is Egypt, right?
Egypt. The south.
King of the north and the south.
King of the north and king of the south started here. And Ptolemy in the south, out of Ptolemy, came Rome.
Well, I think they had an alliance. They formed an alliance. Rome formed an alliance with them.
Yes, but the Bible says, out of one of them, out of one of the four horns. Read that again for us. What the Bible says.
What verse is that?
Where the horns, where the four horns came up.
Well, you're still in Daniel.
Yeah, Daniel 8. The four horns came up, and out of one of them came a little...
So that's 22.
Okay.
So verse 22, now that being broken, whereas four stood up for it, four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation, but not in his power. Is that what you're looking for?
Yeah, go on.
And in the latter times of their kingdom, when the transgressors are come to the full, a king of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences shall stand up, and his power shall be mighty, but not by his own power. And he shall destroy wonderfully, and shall prosper, and practice, and shall destroy the mighty and the holy people.
Mm. Well, that's Rome.
Well, go
back up and see where the four horns, where out of one of them came this horn, and he went south, went to the west.
Isn't that chapter 11 to you? 9?
Chapter 8, verse 9.
And out of one of them, came forth a little horn,
Which
waxed exceedingly great towards the south, and towards the east, and towards the pleasant land. This is Rome again. And because and why I say that? Because the pleasant land here is where. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and off the stars to the ground, and stamped upon them.
Yes. So what we are looking at here now is the birthplace of Rome.
Yeah.
Don't miss that. Rome came out of one of the four generals.
Yeah.
That
Alexander's generals. Yeah.
Yes. And the one that he came out of is the one in Egypt, Ptolemy.
Yeah.
All right?